An elderly spinster pays an awful price when she discovers people boinking in the woods. We're talking Midsomer.
Murder.
And the weirdness that is the Rainbirds on this, the very first episode of...
Welcome to Midsomer.
Hello, and welcome to Midsomer, the podcast where we dissect all the mysteries, the murders, and the many weird things about the long-running hit TV show, Midsomer Murders. I'm your host, Eric Buscher, and with me as always is my co-host, Eileen Becker. Hi, Eileen.
Hey, Eric. This is it, our first episode, and we are very excited to be discussing Midsomer with you. Every month here on Welcome to Midsomer, Eric and I will be discussing a random episode, the plot, the characters, the crazy ways to murder someone, and the hidden dangers of quaint English villages. For our first episode, we decided to discuss the one that started it all, episode one, The Killings at Badger's Drift. Written by Anthony Horowitz and directed by Jeremy Silberston, it originally aired 25 years ago, March 23rd, 1997.
Joining us to discuss this episode, we have a very special guest. She is a best-selling novelist and the Ellery Queen award-winning editor for mystery fiction, and she is a huge Midsomer fan. Please, we want to welcome Juliet Grames to the show. Hey, Juliet!
I cannot tell you how excited I am to be doing this today. This is my bailiwick, Eric and Eileen, so thank you for inviting me. I'm just totally honored.
We're so happy to have you.
When did you first discover Midsomer?
Oh, Eric. Well, what a question to ask me. If I may have the floor just for a moment, I need to tell you my very personal Midsomer story here, because it involves, no boinking in the woods or murder, but it definitely is a sordid story that we should tell from beginning to end. So, okay, I don't know when this was. Maybe 7 or 8 years ago, I came home from a long day at work. And my now husband, was not there. He was out doing something else. I don't know. We work together. As I think, he also works in publishing. He's a book publicist. So we spend most of our time together. So I thought, oh, I'm going to turn on my Netflix and I'm going to indulge in one of my foibles, perhaps the Great British Bake Off or a rom-com of some kind. You know, I know. So I turn on Netflix and it's under recently watched. The top hit is this British procedural I had never heard of called Midsomer Murders. And I was like, well, that's interesting. Paul must have been watching this when I was at home, which was a little surprising to me because usually I would find kind of really low budget 1980s sci-fi horror would be what he would be secretly watching when I'm not home.
Right.
So this happens a couple more times over the course of like a month or 2 months. I come home and I always find Midsomer Murders at the top of the queue. And I start to worry actually because Paul and I spend all of our time together. So I'm like, what is he doing? Is he getting up in the middle of the night to watch Midsomer Murders when I'm not there? Because I had never seen an episode of this show. So finally, one day, I come home and Paul is there and Paul is looking a little bit distressed. He comes out of the kitchen and I see that the TV is on and like Netflix is about to have been selected. And the top hit on Netflix is, of course, Midsomer Murders. And he says, you know, he's trying to joke, you can see, but he's like, hey, so Midsomer Murders. And I was like, yeah, so Midsomer Murders. And he's like, do you want to talk about this? And I was like, yeah, do you want to talk about this? And that's when we realize that we had accidentally left my Netflix logged in when we had visited my parents' house. So they had, because there had been 200 hours worth of Midsomer Murders that had been watched over the course of about a month. And Paul and I are both like, when we're turning on the TV, we're like, how well do we not know our partner here? Where is she finding 200 hours to watch this show? And oh, should I be concerned about the state of my relationship right now? So it kind of became a running joke for us. So we had to sit down and we had to watch Midsomer Murders for ourselves to see what this whole, shtick was about. And thus began the rampant addiction of Midsomer Murders in the greater Grames Oliver family.
It is a show that brings people together.
Uh-huh. Yes. And it forces you to, together, you know, really scrutinize your marriage and see how well you know your partner. And is your partner really the person you want to watch Midsomer Murders with? And luckily the answer is almost always yes.
This is why I stick with cats.
we're going to jump in with a quick recap of the first half of this episode. Spoiler warning, we will be discussing the events of this episode, including the identity of the murderer. So if you haven't watched it yet and don't want to know who done it, pause this and go watch it. We will still be here when you get back.
No, no, don't move.
What is it?
Use your eyes, Troy. Grass flattened, brambles broken.
What, you think someone's been having it away? Is that what happened to Simpson saw? Two people bonking.
Retired school teacher Emily Simpson rides her bike through the village of Badger's Drift on her way to the local forest. She's in a competition with her friend and neighbor Lucy Bellringer to find and photograph a rare orchid. She thinks it's her lucky day when she stumbles upon the orchid, but then she also stumbles across two people having sex in the forest. We don't see them, but Emily gets an eyeful and it freaks her out. She races back to her cottage and calls the local helpline for some advice. She then tries to get a Brighton phone number, but she's interrupted by someone entering her cottage.
I'm Detective Inspector Barnaby, and this is Detective Sergeant Troy.
DCI Tom Barnaby and Sergeant Gavin Troy arrives at Emily's cottage to investigate her death. Coroner Dr. George Bullard informs them that Emily died from a broken neck, possibly from a fall, but scuff marks indicate the body was moved, and Bellringer tells detectives that she is convinced this is foul play. Outside the cottage, they meet local undertaker Dennis Rainbird, who is attempting to collect Emily's body. Dennis is a little over the top, especially when he drives off in his Porsche with a license plate reading RIP1, leaving the officers to wonder how an undertaker can afford such a car. Next, the detectives visit Emily's physician, Dr. Lessiter, who says she was fine for her age. When asked where he was at the time of her murder, he says he was at the hospital, a lie that his daughter, Judith, immediately calls out. Next, he claims he was watching cricket while his wife, Barbara, was out shopping. Judith stomps off to meet Michael Lacey, local artist, and her maybe boyfriend? After Barnaby leaves, Barbara gets a phone call blackmailing her for £500. Barnaby visits the helpline where he learns that Emily was disturbed by something in the woods, but she never said what. Troy brings Barnaby the autopsy results, proving that Emily was murdered. He also developed her photos of the orchid, which leads them into the woods searching for the flower. They find it in a space where they deduce Emily saw some people boinking on a blanket. They pay a visit to the Rainbirds' abode, where we meet Mama Iris, the village blackmailer. She says she saw Catherine Lacey, Michael's sister, in the village on the night of the murder. Catherine is just days from marrying the wealthy Henry Trace, whose first wife Bella died under strange circumstances. Later that night, Dennis brings home the blanket that the murderous lovers tried to destroy. Mom is so happy because this is the big payday that they celebrate with some really weird, gross kissing. Barnaby heads home to his wife Joyce and his daughter Cully, who is visiting from college. Over one of Joyce's terrible dinners, Cully informs them that she has the lead in a play at school. Dinner is interrupted by a phone call from the helpline operator. She remembered that Emily said the phrase, "just like poor Annabella," but didn't know what that was about. Barnaby and Troy drive over to Ty House, home of Henry Trace, in sight of the upcoming wedding. Trace is in a wheelchair due to polio, and he recounts to the detectives the events of Bella's death during a pheasant shoot 2 years prior. Pretty much all her suspects were present, including Bella's sister Phyllis. Bella injured herself when she stumbled over a root, and as she was being escorted home by Michael Lacey, she was shot. Michael ran across the village to call an ambulance. Was it tragedy or something worse? They then talk to Catherine Lacey, who first says she wasn't in the village, but then recalls she went to post a letter, taking her tiny, yappy dog Benji with her. They also chat with Phyllis, who is very freaked out by the sight of police, but claims it's because she hasn't paid her car tax. Even Troy doesn't fall for that one. Next, they head over to interview Michael at the Lacey's cottage on the grounds of Ty House. Henry became the twins' ward after their parents' death and let them stay there. Michael has a studio where he works on a mysterious painting that he doesn't let the detectives see. At Simpson's funeral, everyone turns up to see the fancy satin service. Afterwards, Barnaby and Troy visit Bellringer. She tells them that the Lacey's old nanny was Emily's best friend. She took care of the twins, but their constant fighting finally drove her to leave. Bellringer suspects Catherine of Emily's murder, but when she hears Catherine had the dog with her, that rules her out because the dog would have caused too much noise and given her away. At their home, the Rainbirds enjoy a cart of fancy treats to celebrate a funeral well done. Dennis answers a knock at the door, and just as he says, "Oh, it's you," he's stabbed in the neck. Then the unseen killer stabs Iris to death.
Woo! That's a lot that's happened so far. So let's step back and discuss how Midsomer Murders got made.
This is the very first episode. It's based off novels from the author Carolyn Graham. Her first book, The Killings at Badger's Drift, actually won the 1989 McCavity Award for Best First Novel, and it was named one of the top 100 crime novels of all time by the Crime Writers Association. Graham actually wrote 6 more novels featuring Barnaby, the first 5 of which were adapted as the first 5 episodes of the series. To prep for this, I actually read The Killings of Badger's Drift. Have either of you read the book or familiar with the series at all?
I have not read the book.
I have to say, this is probably one of the most faithful adaptations I have seen. Most of the material of the book is in the show. Some mild tweaks, which we'll get into a little bit later. But everything is there, even down to the weirdness that is the Rainbirds. That is almost a literal translation from the page to the screen. I was shocked. I thought there was going to be a lot more changes made for television, and they really didn't. So Carolyn Graham is a real twisted lady.
Yeah. Eric, I'm so curious because, of course, this episode was scripted by Anthony Horowitz, who is, you know, also a household name in crime fiction, especially recently.
Yes.
Were you able to see his specific hand on the screenplay at all?
It's hard to say. I haven't read a lot of Horowitz to really see the difference. A lot of the dialogue and stuff like that, again, comes straight from the book. I would say, like, there's certain additions, like the dream sequence was probably all him. But no, I think he did a fairly good job of capturing Graham's voice, which, you know, as anyone will tell you, that's a hard thing to do for anyone adapting material is capturing the voice. And like I said, I wasn't sure how much was going to be there, the difference between the book and the show. For a while there, I thought it was probably Horowitz's influence. But no, this is all Graham's baby. They really did follow her.
What a neat thing.
Yeah. Well, the series was optioned by television producer Betty Willingate, and she'd worked on series such as I, Claudius, and North and South, The Mayor of Casterbridge. And you'll see that several actors who appeared in these shows also appear in Midsomer Murders. And she's also the one who so perfectly cast John Nettles as Tom Barnaby. So huge kudos there. She stayed connected to the show until 2019. And passed away in 2021 at the age of 93. So she was working into her 90s.
Wow.
In 2013, when it came time to name John and Sarah Barnaby's daughter, they named her Betty in Willingate's honor, which I thought was just a very wonderful thing.
Yeah, going back to talking about like the book, Barnaby is described as sort of a bearish body type with Nettles. They physically lucked out in that I wouldn't say he's imposing, but he's not barrel chested, but he's a big dude.
He conveys so much through, I mean, yes, his physicality and the way he acts the role is just, it feels so perfect for this part. The thing I was really struck by is how he acts with this area of his forehead right around his eyes. He has this ability to crinkle his eyes and move his eyebrows to convey just so much power in this rather laconic role, right? Barnaby is just one example of incredible characterization that we get in this pilot, right? And I also just think it's so cool how so many of the characters we see in bit parts here go on to have explosive careers elsewhere, much like, you know, now Horowitz is a household name as a writer. But I mean, come on, Emily Mortimer, like in the role of Catherine, like seeing her in this kind of baby face 1997 moment is really neat. Can I just point out the actor who plays Michael, Jonathan Firth, Colin mm-hmm. Firth's brother?
Yep.
But for me, the real scene stealer here is Elizabeth Spriggs, who is, you know, she plays the role of Iris, the blackmailer.
Oh, you must be Mr. Bond. Barnaby, Iris Rainbird, do come in. Oh, and you too, dear, just in time for tea.
I love that actress so much. She is, I don't know if you guys have seen the 1995 Sense and Sensibility. So in that, Elizabeth Spriggs plays the role of Mrs. Jennings, steals basically the entire movie. You cannot take your eyes off that woman when she's on the screen. I love her so much.
For me, when I was like, this was obviously where, you know, I started watching Midsomer, and I was like, oh, well, this is a little darker, a little, and then Dennis Rainbird comes on the screen.
My name is Dennis. Dennis Rainbird. My card.
Marvelously played by Richard Cant. That's the moment I would go, whoa, wait a minute. I can just imagine the casting. It was just like, he comes in, he does it. No, can you do it way over the top? Just go as big as you want, and it works. And it's that's when I kind of realized this show is weird. You know, I was thinking this was going to be a very Murder, She Wrote style show, and it is, but then it's also much weirder. The performances by Spriggs and Cant as the Rainbirds are fantastic. Spriggs not only did Sense and Sensibility, Eileen, you did some research on her. What else did she do?
She has done Bergerac, which was John Nettle's series set in on the island of Jersey. She did Doctor Who, the casebook of Sherlock Holmes. She was the original fat lady in the portrait that guards the entrance to the Gryffindor Tower in Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone. Sadly, she did pass away in 2008 at the age of 78. And but John Nettles did say that she does vicious better than anyone.
I love that they both brought, you know, her and Kant back for the 10th anniversary episode, as they basically just said, well, we killed the Rainbirds, so here's their identical twin cousins.
This is, you know, I was watching
very good.
To prep for this recording, I was rewatching with my mom, you know, as I mentioned, the person who dragged me into Midsomer addiction in the first place. And we're sitting there and she says to me, very like, you know, she's worried about me. She's like, oh, don't worry. They're dying right now, but they're going to come back because the actors are so good. I'm like, come on, mom, spoiler alert much, but. It's just like
Kant, funny enough, is also, you know, he's been in a number of things like Doctor Who, The Crown, but his dad was a well-known presenter of children's television doing shows over there called Play School and Dappledown Farm. And can't you just imagine Dennis Rainbird hosting a children's show?
Oh my God.
With his little cart of sweets.
He is definitely, though, Eric, as you said, he is what anchors you in this world. You know, first of all, you know it's going to be over the top. And then how self-aware he is about when he delivers that line. Like, how do you know that it was a neck thing, right? He goes, well, everyone knows by now it's that sort of village. I mean, he sets up, it's the premise for the whole series. And you're like, thank you, Dennis Rainbird.
Oh, so you do suspect some naughtiness. It was her neck, I understand. Who told you that? Oh, come on, everyone knows by now. It's that sort of village.
Yes.
There's some other notable cast. I just want to call out that Henry Trace is played by Julian Glover. A lot of people will recognize him as Grandmeister Pyzel from Game of Thrones. He appeared in everything from The Avengers and Doctor Who to Magnum P.I. He's played baddies in The Empire Strikes Back, For Your Eyes Only, and Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade, where in that one, much like Henry, he chose poorly.
Well, we've discussed Emily Mortimer, though my fun fact for her is that she is the daughter of Rumple of the Bailey author John Mortimer. And we've discussed Jonathan Firth, who is the brother of Colin Firth. He has also done several other things. He's been on Inspector Morse, Poirot, Father Brown. So he's got his mystery cred there. And Lord Byron in The Highlander, the TV series. He also did several direct-to-video sequels to The Prince and Me, which I did not know had that many direct-to-video sequels.
There is a number of them.
Yes.
Those, I may have watched a few of them on Netflix on those nights before I discovered Midsomer Murders. So.
I think we need to do a little call out to Renee Asherson, who plays Midsomer's very first murder victim, Emily Simpson. She had a very long career. She's performed with Olivier and Gielgud in their production of Romeo and Juliet. And she was Beatrice to Robert Donat's Benedict in Much Ado About Nothing. She actually became Donat's second wife. Her very last role was Old Lady in the Nicole Kidman film, The Others. She also passed away in 2014 at the age of 99.
You know, if we're doing one more call out, another scene stiller, I don't know this actress, but Mrs. Bellringer. I thought...
Oh, Rosalie Gretchen,
you know,
yes.
She, you just, from the one in that opening sequence where you see her picking up the cigarette butt and with that sneer on her face, and then she has that amazing high class accent in this village, and she's guiding the detectives through the bones of what really happened. I mean, she's great. She's great.
She's a standout for me in this, and she's almost a Miss Marple character, but a bit more stern. Yeah. And I could see her almost doing a series. Unfortunately, this was her last role. She did die in 1997 at the age of 77. She appeared in Quo Vadis. She did two versions of Tale of Two Cities, where she played Madame Defarge in both. And then she played Catherine Parr in the acclaimed miniseries The Six Wives of Henry VIII. And this is a real thing that Midsomer finds these great character actors and actresses and really makes the best of them throughout their, sometimes it's their final role, but.
I want to point out that Jessica Hines, who is here as Jessica Stevenson, playing Judith Lessiter, she's had a long career doing drama and comedy. She's won two BAFTAs, but a lot of people know her and lover as the co-creator and co-writer and co-star of the cult classic series Spaced, which launched the careers of Simon Pegg and director Edgar Wright, who would go on to direct Simon in Shaun of the Dead, where Jessica has a fun little cameo as well. And I also got to point out that Christopher Villiers, who plays David Whiteley in this, he's one of the only Midsomer characters who actually comes back as himself in another episode. He actually comes back in the season two opener playing David Whiteley. Spoiler alert, he doesn't survive that one.
Lastly, I want to point out Selena Cadell, who plays Phyllis, the sister in the attic kind of thing. She's probably best known for her portrayal of Mrs. Tischel in the long-running series Doc Martin, where she is really a standout character there. In 2008, she also appeared in the season 11 episode Midsomer Life, where she ended up, unfortunately, in a dryer.
This episode really sets the template for every episode. Like, there really is no variations from this template. It's your typical quaint English village. There's usually some kind of festival or group or weird event. There's one murder case that will always evolve into a double or triple homicide.
Eric, since you bring it up, have you folks done the math on what the statistical average body count in an episode is? And what's the swing here? Like, what's the lowest body count and what's the highest?
The lowest body count is actually zero.
Wow.
And maybe one. It depends on how you interpret it. But there's some that have like six, and six is the highest.
I count seven in this. Is it okay if I, spoilers are fine, right? We've got Emily.
No, that's fine.
Sure. Oh, yeah. We've got Emily. We've got Bella Trace. We've got Dennis and Iris Rainbird. That was quite gruesome. Mm-hmm. Phyllis, I mean, you could say that she was in fact murdered by the circumstances, because although she was driven to suicide, as we learned, she wasn't even a killer. So her guilt was fake. And then, of course, we have Catherine and Michael in a rather interesting culminating execution style scene, which I think we should talk about, the Kurt Cobain kind of how do you shoot yourself with your own rifle aspect of that, but I think maybe that's for a later moment in the podcast.
We're gonna come back to, there is so much about this murder, the actual murders, we're gonna hit on when we hit the second half. I will say is that that's this weird thing of Midsomer, is that it's always, there is no such thing as a single murder. It always develops into, there's another murder, and usually another murder. The murder rate for Midsomer would have to rival Detroit in the 80s. Because just per capita, that is statistically a lot. Like, I can't, in America, your average detective show, right? It's like, they spend an hour trying to solve one. Yeah. Like, Cabot Cove, which would probably be the Murder, She Wrote is probably the American equivalent of Midsomer Murders, only had one murder per episode. And that was a lot, considering 50% of that show took place in a small Maine village.
But the thing is, Midsomer is an entire county, at least. It is not a single village.
It is a county of psychopaths.
It is a county of psychopaths. But let's discuss Midsomer here a little bit, since this is the first episode. So let me set it up a bit. It is a fictional county in England. It's not far from London. The scenes for the show are filmed mainly in Oxfordshire and Buckinghamshire. If it were real, it would be located to the west of London, sometimes vaguely to the northwest. In pre-unified Britain, because I'm a history buff, it would be in the Kingdom of Wessex, with some parts possibly overflowing into Mercia. It's not far from Thame, which often doubles as Corston. Now, Badger's Drift is a village that is located to the south of Corston, and is the setting for six episodes. It has won the best kept village in Midsomer Honor six times, as we see in that first shot. It has a lovely old church with an appropriately creepy churchyard. In future episodes, we see a village fete. Yes, someone dies. A rock music festival. Yeah, someone dies. And a biscuit factory. Well, someone is almost killed, but they get rescued at the last minute. It is a seemingly idyllic village. Quaintness personified. In reality, it is a festering hellhole of blackmail, incest, betrayal, gossip, and murder. In other words, a typical Midsomer village.
You wouldn't think, would you? One small village would have so much trouble bubbling away under the surface.
Let's look at the first murder and just... Why didn't she lock her door? She ran all the way across this village, freaked out. She clearly knew something was wrong. Lock the door?
You'd think it would be second nature. I know for most women it actually is to lock a door, whether it's your car door, your house door, your apartment door. You just get into that habit of locking a door. But I guess she was so intent on calling the National Health Service helpline that she forgot.
But
and that is a weird thing to do after you see two people you know committing incest in the woods, is to call the National Mental Health Service helpline.
What do you think the menu is for that? if you feel depressed, press 1. If you feel suicidal, press 2. If you've seen a brother and sister having sex in the woods, press 3.
I also want to comment, though, before we move on from that opening sequence, on the fact that we home in on Emily's door as she's running through, and it says Beehive Cottage, and then we get a pan out where we see this enormous domicile. I love that this tiny old lady lives in a quote-unquote cottage, and it's just like, I would specially lock my door if I were her, because
it's huge. It's a huge house for a little old lady, retired school teacher. I can't imagine they got paid a whole lot.
You know, if she had survived this episode, I bet we could have excavated some dirty secrets in her past that explained why she lived in such an enormous domicile. But, you know,
she knew everything about her student.
Let's not forget, it's an extraneous detail in this episode that, like, in other episodes, this would be a clue or something like that, but she keeps bees. Like, they're actually, yes. She has, like, it's a bee cottage. Yep. There are bees there. There is that crazy line of just where Bellringer's like, that she needs to inform the bees that someone has died.
I shall have to go over tomorrow. I still haven't told the bees.
Sorry.
Well, you have to tell the bees when somebody dies. Otherwise, they just clear off.
And that is actually an old tradition that happens in Europe, especially in England. It's a very popular thing in England, and it actually comes up again in the later bee episode.
Well, it's funny as in the book, like, she says that line, and then, you know, Barnaby is like, what? And then she explains, no, it's an old European custom. In here, she says the line, and they're just like, oh, yeah, okay. So after the murder, we get our first appearances of Barnaby and Troy. Troy, of course, played by Daniel Casey. Troy, we will see for the next 6 seasons. This was kind of one of his first big roles. He'd been in made appearances in a few other things. His first appearance in anything was he was uncredited in Cracker as a policeman. But man, Troy... As much as we see him evolve over the years, what an awful human being he is in this first episode.
You kind of gotta agree with Dennis Rainbird.
I see you've got a right constable there.
Right constable.
I just love the scene when we first see him in that eye-jarringly orange shirt with the triple striped tie. He's got that purple and red striped tie. I'm like, oh, Troy, I get you. And my mom, who's sitting there again with me watching, she has to warn me before he gets in the car, oh, by the way, you should know Troy is a very bad driver. I'm like, well, the camera tells no lies, Mom. We can see him swerving all over the road.
I mean, in the book, again, like, they actually lightened Troy up a little bit for the show. In the book, he's really kind of hoping Barnaby fails. He thinks Barnaby is completely wrong all the time. He's kind of an obsessive jerk. In here, he's just, you know, he's homophobic. He's kind of an incompetent. But he sets the template, you know, his job is to say the wrong thing so Barnaby can correct him.
One gets the idea that this is Troy's first week. And if it's not, he hasn't learned a whole lot yet.
And then, of course, we meet him in comparison to the Rainbirds. That way, he says constable with a U.
They got away with that one.
They got away with it. Like, even Nettles was like, yeah, we got away with it. There's a lot of incest in this episode, but it starts off with the Rainbird sort of.
Oh, this is the big one, Denny. This is going to make us very, very rich.
Mommy.
Who's a good boy, Denny? Who's a good boy?
It's almost like the Rainbirds are so gross at it, so that when you see the Lacys later on, it goes, well, that's what normal incest is supposed to look like. Here's my question about the Rainbirds. So as we've discussed, Midsomer drops, there's a lot of bodies are dropping in Midsomer.
Yeah.
Undertaking must be an incredibly lucrative business. Then why do they need to blackmail anybody?
It's a good question.
I always think it never hurts to have a little extra income, a little side hustle. I mean, he got a Porsche with a personalized license plate. I'm just saying.
But he could have afforded that with the cost, like with the funerals from just the bodies in this episode.
Well, he did give Miss Simpson a discount for the satin service because she taught his mom. So,
my other question is, so is that tray just constantly full in their house?
We have to talk about the tea tray. I was like, when is this going to come up?
Yes.
I couldn't even, did someone cut each of those tiny sandwiches into a club formation before smearing it with, what was it?
The clubs are anchovy, salmon spread in the hearts, Marmite spades, and potted meat diamonds.
Anchovy or Marmite or something,
also,
yes.
Also, what is an iced sombrero?
But also, like, when does he prep that? Like, does he get up at like 4 a.m, make all these little sandwiches, the ice sombreros and all that stuff, and then just in case somebody pops over?
They have a full afternoon tea. This is a full afternoon tea they do. And apparently they do it every day.
And it may also be, though, that may be their sort of like office for their blackmailing when they're inviting a client in. You know, it's because we see that in one case, right? When Phyllis comes for tea and they have the rifle on the tea tray.
Yeah.
So maybe that's just part of their whole business. You know, it's important to make the clients feel at home before you hit them up for £5,000.
And I think the reason you do see them come back, they miss an opportunity when they, like, because as an undertaker, this guy could have popped up in multiple episodes as just weirdo information
so
brokers.
True.
Fun fact, in the book, Dennis survives.
Oh.
Only Mama gets murdered. Dennis is supposed to be murdered, but he comes home a little too early for the Lacey's plans. And he just finds his beloved mother there with her head almost cut off. And he goes catatonic. And he is catatonic from like the second half of the book.
Wow.
When they killed him, I was sad.
Yeah.
Because they were such great characters.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I actually think that is a really important moment, the slashing moment, because it's another, this is a bar that the series is setting for us. I think this gets to the core of what the stickiness about Midsomer Murder is, why we come back to the series over and over. It's because it is a safe place for us. So we have that incredibly stylized, like a less realistic depiction of violence I have never seen in my life. And I've seen a lot as a crime fiction editor. And this is where, you know, if it sounds like I'm being sarcastic about any of these aesthetic choices in this series, I'm not. I'm absolutely not. This is why this genre works. It's a place of safety. We know we're never going to get realistic violence. This is a form of sort of a fantasy where we can have murder mysteries and puzzle mysteries that are unfolded in a world that is not like our own, where 7 people may be murdered in a tiny village and where everyone is sort of a psychopath. We don't have to delve too deeply into the real human psychology behind the mysteries, but we can still get the craft of the puzzle as it unfolds. And to that end, we need to feel so safe in these moments where, you know, the violence will be incredibly stylized, unrealistic, where we get those musical cues that we come to rely on. Like, you know, the opening sequence has that gorgeously campy, amazing theme song. You hear it and it gets your blood pumping because you're like, I'm about to be wickedly entertained with a murder mystery that will not gross me out. And I think the killing of the Rainbirds sets our expectations for what will unfold over the next, how many, 129 episodes?
Before we get to we break for the second half, I just want to point out this is also our introduction to the Barnaby family. and a rarity for mysteries, it's a happy, healthy family life.
It is. It very much is. And of course, a lot of that is set by John Nettles as Barnaby, but also his wife Joyce, who's played by Jane Waymark. Before being abandoned by her TV husband at every restaurant in Midsomer, which is the only sticking point in their marriage, Waymark appeared in Rob Roy, the original 1970s Poldark, Pie in the Sky, which I love, and A Touch of Frost. Since Midsomer, she's been mainly retired, though she did appear in an episode of the Jean Reno crime drama Joe.
The big thing, the big character, the trait that comes through for Joyce in this episode is the cooking. Later on over the series, she's always taking a class. But yes. In this, it's that Joyce is, and they never quite say it out loud. In the book, it is described as she is an atrocious cook, that she is a maker of abominations in the kitchen.
That's amazing.
Here, it's always just implied with looks. When Cully brings home the Marks and Spencers.
Yeah, amazing.
That classic line, you can't go wrong with Delia Smith.
What's this then?
It's Delia Smith. Stewed neck of lamb with mushroom dumplings. You can't go wrong with Delia Smith.
Yeah, that's what I've always thought.
And Barnaby's face is just kind of going, I think you can. I think you can.
Challenge.
Barnaby, and the constant rule of the show is that you never get to see Barnaby have a full meal.
Yeah.
He never gets to finish eating anything. We meet Cully, played by Laura Howard. She appeared in a show called So Haunt Me before this and a drama series called Soldier Soldier. Since Midsomer, she's appeared in Casualty, Called the Midwife, and Young Dracula.
What's interesting is that she's named after the place in France where Joyce and Tom had their honeymoon. Cully in France.
I've always felt that Cully is sort of an underwritten character. She's sort of defined by her constant, like, first few seasons, she wants to be an actress, and then after that's radically shifted, and she seems to be constantly defined by she doesn't know what she wants to do with her life.
Well, she's always trying to be an actress. It just never seems to work out too much, so she has to take these other side jobs.
But again, it's interesting to see it's a healthy home life. The Barnaby is a relatively healthy individual. He is not dark or brooding. He's not self-destructive. He's not a lot of tropes of detective fiction. He's not even really kind of a jerk.
Yeah. He turns down a drink when Cully offers him one. So it's like, well, he's not the alcoholic detective that's become such the cliche. Now, the last character we haven't talked about yet, who's a regular, is Dr. George Bullard, the pathologist, played by Barry Jackson. Jackson, again, is another one who's had a long career. He appeared in so many things on TV and in movies. He pretty much retired from acting after he left Midsomer, and he passed away in 2013.
He doesn't get a lot of screen time here, but over the course of the season, he does fulfill a major function, which is info dump. Let me give Barnaby a huge chunk of info to cut some time this episode.
You always need an info dump character in a mystery, though.
All right, we're going to take a break here, and we'll be back in a little bit with our second half of Killings of Badger's Drift. And we're back. Let's take a look at the second half of the Killings of Badger's Drift.
Looks like Emily Simpson was murdered after all.
I'm amazed, Troy.
Barnaby and Troy arrive at the Rainbirds, where Bullard tells them that it's one of the worst scenes he's ever been to. Mama's head was almost cut clean off. Upstairs, the detectives find their blackmail operation, including tons of journals, binoculars, and cameras. Unfortunately, the killer has already torn pages out of the most recent journal, hiding their identity. The cleaning lady tells them she saw Catherine Lacey at the Rainbird's doorstep just before she discovered the bodies. The detectives sneak on over to the Lacey's cottage to catch them unawares. They overhear the twins having a huge fight over Catherine's wedding that ends with both of them storming out. Barnaby decides to enter the cottage without a warrant to have a little look around. However, they don't go into the studio, which would require breaking the door down. That's a little too much. They return to Ty House, where Catherine says yes, she was at the Rainbirds, but only to deliver some mushrooms. But they aren't really there to interrogate her. Going through the Rainbirds' journals, they find evidence that Phyllis killed Bella. Phyllis admits it instantly, and they arrest her. She had been in love with Henry and decided to get Bella out of the way. So on the day of the shoot, she got drunk on vodka to steady her nerves, and when she saw Michael walking with Bella, she fired. The Rainbirds found out and blackmailed her. But she didn't kill them. She had already been bled dry. Sure, because no one has ever murdered anyone for revenge. They also drag in handyman David Whiteley, who the Rainbirds had discovered was having an affair with Barbara Lessiter and was blackmailing her. However, Whiteley and Lessiter were together when Simpson was killed, so they each cover each other's ass. I mean, alibi. They did luckily witness Michael Lacey at the Rainbird store just before they were murdered. With a warrant to search the cottage, the detectives find the bloody knife in the studio. Lacey claims they planted it and makes a run for it, getting tackled to the ground by Troy in the only useful thing he does in the entire episode. As he's driven away, he sees Catherine and tells her he's been framed using the most obvious box symbol in the world. Next is a bizarre dream sequence where Barnaby attends the wedding and all the clues and the suspects are there and his brain tries to make sense of it, causing his head to start shaking like he was a bobblehead. He is woken up by tragic news. Phyllis has killed herself in the jail. Barnaby angrily blames himself, and his mood isn't helped when Michael, after spending the night in jail, suddenly reveals he has an alibi for the murder. He was with Judith Lessiter all day. Barnaby's no dummy. He realizes that Michael was trying to keep him from seeing the secret painting, a painting that is now missing from the studio. Barnaby thinks he has it worked out, and he takes Troy down to Brighton for a fun beach day and to get some answers from the former nanny, Mary Sharp. Through tears, she tells Barnaby about raising them while dealing with their constant screaming matches. But she felt that something was odd about the fighting, and she was proven right one night when she witnessed the twins in bed together. And they weren't fighting. She retired and moved to the seaside rather than tell anyone about the incest, as she still loves them and doesn't want to hurt them. Barnaby drives them back and gives Troy and us the reveal. Michael and Catherine have been in it together the whole time. Catherine murdered Emily, trying to make it look like an accident, giving Michael her dog to hold so it wouldn't bark. She also killed the Rainbirds, dressed as Michael, then changed her clothes and made sure she was seen knocking on the door, but unable to get in. It was all an elaborate plan to throw the detectives off the scent. Have all the evidence point to Michael, but when he has a clear alibi, it means he was set up. All their arguments were faked as well. They've been at this for a while, as they were also responsible for the murder of Bella Trace. Phyllis only thought she shot Bella, but she was drunk and missed, mistaking Bella stumbling over a root as her being shot. Then Michael walked Bella right to where Catherine was waiting to shoot her. All of this is an elaborate plan for Catherine to eventually marry Henry and take his money over his dead body. Unfortunately, the nanny calls Michael to warn them. Michael runs and grabs Catherine and takes her to their secret bonking spot, where they die in a murder-suicide. Barnaby finds the missing painting, an erotic portrait of Catherine. Finally, what was that thing about Annabella? Barnaby doesn't know and assumes he never will, until he attends Cully's play, where she plays a woman named Annabella, involved in incestuous romance with her brother. Realizing what Emily was saying, Barnaby has himself a little laugh at the totally wrong time. So, this is a very convoluted murder plot.
It is very convoluted. And the thing is that for something that is played off as being a spur-of-the-moment plot, it's very elaborate. And one has to wonder where the dog was while they were bonking in the woods, because he had to be around somewhere because there wasn't enough time. I mean, Emily Simpson goes straight back to her house, doesn't even bother locking the door before she calls the National Health Service mental health line, and then she starts to call Brighton. That's a very short amount of time for them to get this whole thing together.
You know, Catherine clearly is a murderous individual, that she can come up with these plots pretty quick. I mean, it wasn't long between the Rainbirds starting to blackmail them and they just kill them the next day. Which, by the way, The Rainbirds already suspect that they're involved in something that probably was involved in Emily's murder. Why would you open? You wouldn't even open the door, let them in.
Well, maybe they thought she was bringing money.
I do also appreciate how Dennis kind of dramatically bleeds across the foyer, walking back to his mom before collapsing. You think he could have like put up some other kind of alert, knocked down a vase or a vase, excuse me. I don't know. I had questions about that as well. But I think we just have to accept that Catherine is a very charismatic murderer and she's just able to pull off this violence with aplomb.
She certainly does. I love the way she gives that look before she pulls the knife out of the basket.
Yeah, it's a little sassy.
Yes.
It's a little sassy for murder. There's a lot of incest in this episode, from the Rainbirds to the Lacys. But even if you think about it, that Henry Trace is their ward. That's technically, he is the parent surrogate.
Mm-hmm.
And he is marrying what's technically a person that he's a good raised.
Point. Good yeah. point.
And Phyllis was in love with her brother-in-law, yep. Henry.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Good point.
Also, the whole thing, too, about Michael Lacey, like the whole, I'm going to make it look like Michael. And then, which, by the way, they don't quite explain it in the show, but in the book, it's because Michael Lacey constantly wears a denim jacket and a cap. Like you see her wearing the cap in the show, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like, there's nothing that indicates that this outfit is Michael Lacey. They yeah. don't look alike.
Maybe at some previous time. Well, what's interesting to me is there's some, and I think there's just some editing things, which you will appreciate, Juliet, some errors. The housekeeper says she comes on Tuesday mornings and Friday afternoons, which if you really pay attention to the timeline, the only way she could find the Rainbird's body after the funeral is on a Friday afternoon, which means a week goes by with nothing happening because Emily Simpson is murdered on the previous Wednesday, not the Wednesday before. So there's a whole lot of time that goes by. So you kind of have to adjust your brain that says, well, maybe she's there on a Tuesday afternoon instead or a Monday afternoon, which would make a lot more sense because that way the timeline actually works.
I don't know if this is an editing error, but I was very confused by the painting that's discovered at the end that is apparently revelatory because it illustrates the incest between brother and sister, but does not to me look even remotely like Emily Mortimer.
Yes. It looks, first of all, it's got a very Lucian Freud quality it, but it doesn't look like her at all.
No, also, in fact, maybe more like Judith Lessiter, if anything, the eye color is what really stuck out to me. I'm like, anyway.
Why paint that? I don't care. I don't care if you're like an artist and you have to make art. You're involved in a complicated murder plot.
Yeah.
That this would give it away.
My take is that he needed something while she was married to Henry before they killed him to, I don't know, maybe jerk off to while she was.
But also, when you rewatch this episode knowing who the killer is, and then you hear when Emily discovers them having sex, and you hear the sex sounds in the forest. It's clearly Michael Lacey. Like, every other male character in the show's voice is two octaves lower. It's clearly Michael Lacey's voice.
Today, though, Emily would have had an iPhone with her instead of a camera, and she would have taken video. Case solved right away.
So, I do think it's just kind of going back to the incest, that this incest becomes a frequent motif. I can at least think of like four or five episodes where incest plays a big part of it. Why so much incest in Midsomer?
Insert joke about that kind of village.
I think we should look a little bit at some of the detective work here. The illegal search of the cottage.
Yeah, there you go.
Yes.
Also the weird sneaking up. Like, I just like, we're creeping up to hear the fight. I don't know how they knew we were coming. There's a mirror. It's not even a subtle mirror. That's a traffic mirror.
Yeah.
I do, though, appreciate when they find Iris's journals that we see Barnaby up late at night going through and trying to, you know, pick through the details. Yeah. I mean, that's like, this is a joke in crime fiction, right? That the actual detective work is incredibly boring, like gumshoe work, door to door, boring questions, asking them again and again. The realism of solving crime, which is so rarely depicted in crime fiction. And then I love, maybe my favorite moment in the whole show is when Cully asks him, like, well, how's the case going, Dad? Is it murder? And he goes, well, it's certainly a lot of hard work. Zing, Barnaby. Yeah. It's great.
There's a point where Barnaby's talking with Cully, and Barnaby kind of admits that it's good that the Rainbirds were murdered because it's better for solving cases because it gets everything turning.
Was it very horrid? The bodies?
I've seen worse. I think you don't really bothered me, Cully. I didn't feel anything, not for Iris Rainbird or her son.
Well, they were very nice people.
Well, they're people. All I could think about was another death. Gets the machinery moving again. More clues, more statements. But I'm one step further down the road.
I think that was kind of a weird thing for a murder detective to talk to admit.
Yeah, I thought it was a little bit psychopathic, especially, you know, he says in that conversation, I don't have any emotions about this, right? And it's which is, you know, maybe a way of capturing the realism of this life where you have to divorce in the way that a surgeon cannot think about the body as, you know, the person, but in fact the you know, what they're working on, the detective must divorce him or herself from the fact of the violence if they want to intellectually address the problem that they've been paid to address. But also, more broadly, let's talk about rampant psychopathy in Midsomer. Okay, mm-hmm. Let's talk about the fact that Phyllis, when we see her murder her sister, we get the play-by-play of how she commits the murder, but we never like really drill down on what makes a person decide to murder their sister. Like, that's the real question here, right?
Yeah.
I think that that's like part of the thing that you just have to accept, that we're going to see a lot of people die by violence and that we're not going to dig too deep into the human motivations, or else we're going to have to reveal that everyone in this county apparently is a little bit of a psychopath.
By that sort of statement, like, they literally could just, like, DCI Barnaby, there's been a body. It's like, well, I'm going to get some tea and some lunch somewhere. Let me know when a second body is dropped.
Yeah. No, because then we'll be able to... Obviously, the lunch will have to be cut short.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, definitely. Because we'll get some sort of revelation in the middle of it. Of course, if he'd run lines with Cully, he could have solved this whole thing much sooner.
There you go.
Because, and I want to talk about his pity, she's a whore for a minute.
Yep.
But she said, just like poor Annabella.
This is a play that's written by John Ford and was first performed around 1629 to 1633. And to put him in a historical context, he was born about 40 years after Shakespeare. The play centers on an incestuous relationship between a brother named Giovanni and a sister named Annabella, which if was the character being played by Cully, was Annabella. So if Barnaby had run the lines, he would have gotten the Annabella thing.
But wait, she ran lines with Joyce, right?
She did run line with
Joyce. And Joyce knew about Annabella. Barnaby mentioned it to Joyce. Either Joyce was just like, I'm having fun, because he's going to run out on dinner sometime, so screw him. I'm just going to keep this from him, make his life harder. Or Joyce would have to be real dumb. And as we've seen, Joyce ain't dumb.
No. But anyway, it's a very complicated plot. There's a lot of characters. She has all these suitors. She marries this rich guy. The incest is discovered. He actually kills her, and then he goes out with her heart on a knife, and her husband like goes after him and has all of his thugs go after him. So Giovanni basically commits suicide by cop kind of thing. Obviously, this is a very controversial play because of its subject matter. And it's the Victorians were just like totally in a swoon over it because they could not, they changed the title of the play. They left it off of his list of plays and books and would not include it. On the mid 20th century, it started getting a little bit looked at again, and people have realized that it's a very complicated play. There's a lot that's very passionate about it and powerful about it, even though it's still very unsettling. But the fact that Giovanni, who's this talented noble man, is committing incest with his sister, and she's portrayed very sympathetically as well, was really very controversial for centuries, basically.
So in the book, Cully is barely in the book. She only kind of really appears at the end of the book where they do go see the play. And that's where they like put the two and two together. Like it's, oh, Annabella, now I get it. And then that scene at the end where Tom just is having a little chuckle at the scene where like the brother and sister are kissing.
Very inappropriate.
So we were talking a lot about the template. But there are a couple things in this episode that we don't really see again in Midsomer, or they get dropped off the show very quickly. Number one, the title cards.
Mm. Yeah, with a quaint little village with a little cat that goes through it.
Yeah. There's also that point halfway through the show where Barnaby's driving to the funeral and he starts reviewing the suspects. In case you haven't been watching the last hour, here's how it goes. You know, was it this doctor or was it his daughter? I was like, why are you telling this to Troy? Troy should know all this.
It is Troy's first week, in my mind at least.
And then the dream sequence.
Oh, yes. Amazing. When you get the first like notion that it's the dream sequence is that those popsicle sticks with the red ribbons tied in her bouquet. And bouquet. My initial reaction is horror. I'm like, what? She cut those orchids? But then it starts to sink in. Oh, this isn't really happening.
My first reaction was like, wait, who invited them to the wedding?
My first thing was the red bouquet, all those red ribbons dripping down like blood. Yeah, there's a lot more blood imagery in this than we get in a normal, you know, especially later on, Midsomer episode.
The Rainbirds in the background, paler than normal.
Catherine does go ahead and wears that bright red scarf to Emily's funeral, which I thought was a little ostentatious of her, but whatever.
Yeah. And then Barnaby's whole thing at the end with that weird head shaking.
Yeah.
Like he's out of scanners or something. It was just, you know, this was like, this dream sequence might as well have just been, hey, can you figure it out? here's clues you didn't even realize were clues. I think the last big question I have, just thinking about all of this, was how old do you have to be for a nanny?
Yeah, that's the thing that struck out to me when the nanny was saying, Michael was 18 and Catherine was 17. And I was like, and they still had a nanny. I just don't think Mary Poppins would have stuck around that long.
I mean, and then at the end, the fact that she calls them to warn them.
Yeah.
We don't really plumb that one, do we?
Yeah.
It's, I mean, I get it. She loves them and she wants to save them from getting arrested. But like, what was, like, I guess that at that point, what were they going? Like, I understand. That's like the one thing that kind of made sense to me in the whole thing. I was like, yeah, they're busted. Like they can't run. They got no money. If they get arrested, they'll never get to be together again.
Mm-hmm.
The only way out, I guess, is to and then of course they're just like, nah, we're too late. They're probably dead by now.
Yeah. And we don't even get to see poor Henry's reaction.
It seems a little bit irresponsible to not at least try to track them down, because who knows, they could have gone on another murder spree, killed another 17 people, but
they could have. You know. We could have gone natural born killers.
Yeah, for sure.
But then just there's like, yeah, they've probably killed themselves. It's like, they could have made a run for it. What the?
It's Barnaby's deep knowledge of human psychology that lets him so confidently make that, deduction.
I mean, at least just go down the road a little bit. Maybe you'll see, you know, Michael Lacey just doing some of that weird running, trying to get away.
Yeah.
They, you
or
know,
at least the... one last bonking.
Two people bonking.
Well, you know, in the book, the murder of Emily Simpson is with Hemlock. They try to pass it off that that she, because Hemlock looks a lot like parsley, I guess, or like an herb. So they were trying to pass it off that she poisoned herself accidentally, and then they also take Hemlock to kill themselves at the end.
Oh, interesting.
You know, and you know, they point out in the book that hemlock takes a little while, so they could have, like, you know, decided to take some hemlock and go out one last bonk.
Yeah. I was hoping they were going to use poisonous mushrooms, like that's what I was hoping that basket had been introduced for in the first place.
They saved that for another episode.
Yeah. Yes. So
what are our final thoughts on the killing of Badger's Drift? Juliet, you're the guest. What are your final thoughts about this as an episode or as a launching pad?
Well, I wish there had been more badgers.
Not a single badger.
Nary a badger. That's my only complaint. I really think that, you know, in, as I said before, we have in very good humor poked a little fun at some of the formulas that and conventions that the series sets up for us, but I think that it operates at the very highest level for the genre that it is, which is this safe space of crime fiction entertainment puzzle mystery. Obviously very addictive, just makes you want to go and watch another one tonight and probably maybe two more tonight. I mean, I see how my mom ended up mainlining 200 hours worth of this in 1 month, thereby causing me and my husband to question our relationship. But I, you know, it's just, also a creature of its time. It has, in many ways, late 90s stamped on it. There's so many aspects of this filming that wouldn't have happened in the exact pattern that they did happen if it were being made today. And I think that this is also kind of the burgeoning moment of when this genre takes off. The impact of this series on the rest of British crime fiction, which then becomes world crime fiction, can't be overstated, right? Yeah. So yeah, I mean, welcome to Midsomer. Let's have a little more murder.
I love it. I think it's unlike a lot of pilots where they make so many changes afterwards. All the elements are there. The cast is there. All the elements are there. They take out a few things, you know, and streamline a few things. But for a first episode, it's amazing how the whole world has already been set up. Mm-hmm. Midsomer is what it is. We know what's going to happen in every other village in Midsomer because Badger's Drift has already set the template for it.
I agree. I think this is actually one of the stronger pilots because Carolyn Graham created such a strong template with the books, and the producers really just seem to understand intuitively by centering it on a warmer detective with a happy home life. We're not stuck in this sort of like a weird brooding detective that just, you can't get 25 years with a miserable guy. Like you have to have that kind of strong core. And I think the other thing that really the Rainbirds kind of highlight is the weirdness to it. Like what makes Midsomer is the weirdness at its heart. It's the weirdest episodes of Midsomer that always stand out, that people keep coming back to.
One other thing I think it also sets up is the great cast that it brings in for each episode, all these great character actors. And you have these great Shakespearean trained actors. Eventually you get the Mark Williams, you get the Honor Blackmans, you get the David Warners and the Edward Foxes and the Simon Callows. I mean, these are good, good character actors. These are name people. These are people you have seen in some of your favorite movies, and they're on Midsomer Murders.
50% of it is John Nettles is Detective Barnaby. He is, they found like just found a winning combination with him in this material. I would say this is easily one of the top episodes of the series.
I think it's important not to undersell the production value of this, though, because it's one of the things that makes, you know, it is self-aware in its weird. And the creative team behind this episode, they went to the sky on every single, like, they took everything to its, upteenth possible limit. I mean, when you first meet, when you go into the neighbor's house and we see her line of mugs along her escritoire or whatever it is. And I just thought to myself, wow, the detail that they're bringing to bear on this scene development. Even later in the studio sequence, when they're breaking into Michael's studio and we see onions drying along the pillars outside of his door. I just thought, who was making these tiny detailed decisions? Like there's so much thought and craft that went into every scene that we get to see, and appreciating those details is part of the fun of this. Mm-hmm. Someone spent time thinking about it and refining it in this way that is not a lo-fi tropey murder mystery. Yeah, I mean, this is a project. Many creatives brought this project to us for our appreciation.
There were so many elements that could have gone wrong and didn't.
I think it is a fantastic launching pad for Midsomer Murders, and it's a fantastic launching pad for us, and I'm glad we had so much to talk about. I want to thank Juliet Grames for joining us. Juliet, please pimp your stuff. Tell everybody where they can find you, what you're working on, tell about your fantastic novel.
Thank you, Eric and Eileen. This has just been so much fun. I am a crime fiction editor at Soho Press. If you like to read crime fiction as much as you like to watch it on TV, we have some fantastic, specifically British procedurals for you to check out. So I'll briefly stump Mick Herron. You should check out Mick Herron's Slough House series because it will be airing on Apple TV starting this spring, starring Gary Oldman and my personal favorite, Kristen Scott Thomas. So, I mean, if you just want funny British crime fiction, go ahead. Mick Herron, start with Slow Horses I will plug that. And I think, Eric, you're trying to let me generously plug my own novel, The Seven or Eight Deaths of Stella Fortuna, which is not a crime novel, but I'm working on a crime novel now. So I hope I'll have that to offer you in the next 4 to 5 years.
I want to thank you so much for joining us. I want to thank everyone for listening to us. If you had anything you wanted to discuss about the killings in Badger's Drift or Midsomer Murders in general, please feel free to email us at welcometomidsomer@gmail.com. We're also Welcome to Midsomer on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. If you liked what you heard, please consider subscribing to us or rating and reviewing us on iTunes. That would really help people find us. And tell all your friends about it. We're going to be back next month. We're going to be talking about the episode The Maid in Splendor. And so we will hope you will join us again for that one. And as we take the road out of Midsomer, we want to thank you for listening and remind you that in Midsomer Worthy, answering the door can be murder. And it probably is. Welcome to Midsomer is produced by Eric Buscher and Eileen Becker. All clips in this podcast are used in compliance with the U.S. Copyrights Act Fair Use Exemption for criticism and commentary.